Good morning all. So I want to do a small problem session. So there was this problem called digital root of an integer that was given as part of the assignment. And I thought I'll show you how to solve it live. So we'll talk about the solution as we do it on paper and pencil. And then we'll see how to translate that to a program. So I'm going to take five examples here, namely 1233, 1234, and so on. And I'll show you what really happens in each one of them. So the digital root is defined as sum of all the digits in a number. So for 1, 2, 3, 3, it's 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 3. So in this case, the summation is 9. And once you hit a single digit number, we stop there. So 9 is a single digit number, we stop there. However, for 1, 2, 3, 4, it's 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4. So in this case, the result would be a 10. But we don't stop it there because 10 is a two digit number. We take 1 and 0 and add it together, we get 1. So 1 is the final answer for this. Let's take these examples, 65536. So 6 plus 5 plus 5 plus 3 plus 6. So that's 6 plus 10, 16, 19, 25. So this is 25. So 2 plus 5 is 7. That's already a single digit number, we can stop. Then I have taken these slightly larger examples, 9 plus 1 plus 5 nines. So that's 6 nines, which is 54, plus 1, which is 55. But now you add 5 and 5 together, you get a 10. We cannot stop here. In the previous cases, we could have stopped slightly earlier, but now we cannot stop. Now add 1 plus 0 together, the result is a 1. And this last example where we have 9, 6 followed by 6 nines, and that would be 7 nines, which is 63, plus 6, which is 69. Now you add 6 plus 9 together, that gives you 15. And 1 plus 5 together, which is 6. So when we hit a single digit number, we can stop. So this is the definition of a digital root. And what I have done is, it looks like I can see 1, 2, 3, 3 here, and I can extract the digits. But you cannot do this in a program like this. So instead, what I'm going to do is, I'm going to show you how to write a program for this. Right? So let's look at 1, 2, 3, 3. What do we need for 1, 2, 3, 3? I want to extract one digit at a time. Right? And to extract one digit, I'm going to use two operators, namely the div operator or slash and mod operator or percentage. So if I do a percentage 10 of this, I get 3, which is the last digit. But if I do a slash 10 of that or divide by 10, so that's an integer, 10 is an integer. If I divide, I will get 123. So this gives me one digit. So let me write it down here. Then I take 123, I do a mod 10. I get 3, so again, I need to note it down. And 123 div 10 would be 12. So I can add this up, the result is now 6. Then I take 12 itself, do a mod 10, that gives me 2. So I can add 6 and 2, that's 8. Right? And 12 divided by 10 is 1. And finally, if I take 1 modulo 10, that's a 1. And 1 div 10 is a 0. So 1 modulo 10 is a 1. If I add it together, so 8 plus 1 is 9. So at this point, it's a single digit number. And we have destroyed the value of n. So we have extracted all the digits of the number that is input. So we can stop and print this result. So in this case, we got slightly lucky because we went over one iteration of all the numbers, and we ended up with a single digit number itself. So this may not be the case, but let's first write a program to add up all the digits of a number, and then we will worry about if the number is greater than 9 or not. So let's write a small program for that. So I'm going to write, I'm going to scan a number called n. But before that, we need the basic template. So that's the basic template. And what am I going to do? I'm going to have an integer n. But since I'm also adding digits, we need two variables. So one is going to accumulate the sum, and another is going to be n itself. So I need a sum, and it's always a good practice to initialize things that are being summed up. So I'll do it right here. Sum equals to 0 is initialized. And I'm going to scan the number from the user. So I'm scanning the number. notice that I didn't prompt the user to say like enter the number or anything. I'm just scanning because that's what the portal takes, right? So I'm scanning the number directly, and what am I going to do? I'm going to write a loop now which says while n is greater than 0, right? Because once you hit 0, we know that we have actually extracted all the digits. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to add sum plus equals n mod 10, so that extracts the last digit of n, but I also want to destroy n by a factor of 10 every round. So I do n equals n by 10, and what do you get here? So at the end of this, your sum will be the summation of everything that we have seen so far, right? So this is not the final solution to the problem. So if I put sum here, I will see that. So let me save this. I'm going to save it as a program, right? I have saved this and I'll compile it. So thankfully there are no compilation errors. I'll run it and I'm going to try these examples. So let's start with 1, 2, 3, 3 as an example. So let me try it. Hold on. 1, 2, 3, 3, and 1, 2, 3, 3 gives me 9 as expected, so which is good. So I'm going to try it on all the examples that I have just to ensure that this first step is correct, because if this step is wrong, everything else is going to be wrong. So 1, 2, 3, 4, if I add up, it's 10, then 6, 5, 5, 3, 6 should add up to 25, so which is good. Then 9, 1, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 9s should add up to 55, which is also correct. And finally, 9, 6 followed by 6 9s should add up to 69. So we have, so far we seem to have taken all the digits and added them up, and we got a multi-digit number. But however, in this case, except for 1, 2, 3, 3, all the other things gave two-digit numbers, and we may have to do this process once more. So the program that we have is currently not sufficient. Instead, we need to take this new sum as n and repeat the process. So I'll just reiterate what I said. So at this point in line number 12, we know that this is a program which can take the digits of a number and sum it up, right? So but then this may result in a multi-digit number by itself. So if I give you a sufficiently large number, it may not even be a two-digit number. It may become a three-digit number, right? So however, the result is stored in a sum. But if I run the same program on that number once more, I'll get the result, correct? So let's say I put in 65536, so I got 25. I can always ask the user, run the program once more with 25 in it, you get 7, at this point you stop. But that's not a good way to write programs. In this case, we are asked to write a program which will do this whole process without having the user to run the program multiple times. So the key thing is, at this point, this summation, the sum, has the value that you need. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to take n as sum, and let's say I have a mechanism by which I take this point from line number 13, I need to go back to line number 8 and iterate this whole process once more. If I'm capable of doing that, then this would solve the problem. And what is it that we did at this point? At this point, since I'm going for the second round, the previous sum is incorrect anymore. So I need to initialize sum equals to 0 once more, right? And what I'm going to do now is I'm going to put a while loop now. So when will this happen? When do we need a while loop? If the number is greater than 9, that's when we'll need a while loop, right? So I did one iteration and the result was greater than 9. Only then we'll need a while loop. So I'm going to base this condition while n is greater than 9. Do everything here, right? So I'm going to adjust the indentation so that you know what is happening. All right, so at this point it's still not what the program expects, but let's try and compile it and run it, right? So I'm going to try with 1, 2, 3, 4 to start with. So 1, 2, 3, 4 gave a 101. So that's actually 10 followed by a 1. So to just see what the initial sums are, I'm going to put a backslash n so that we can see what the individual iterations give. So I compile and run again. I give 1, 2, 3, 3. That's a 9 itself. Then I give 1, 2, 3, 4. That gives a 10 followed by 1, which is good. 6, 5, 5, 3, 6. 25 and then 7, which is again good. Right? And 9, 1, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So 5 nines. That's 55. 5 plus 5 is 10. 10, 1 plus 0 is 1. So it seems to be correct. And finally, 9, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 nines. That starts with a 69 and then a 15 and then 6. It seems to be correct. So what I'm going to do now is, it seems to be a program which is correct except for this last thing that we are doing, this printf. We are printing everything, right? So clearly our program does not expect all of this. So what I'm going to do is comment this line and put a printf here. So I'm going to print n here, right? So if I put a printf here, then what it means is n is guaranteed to be less than or equal to 9, right? Because otherwise you would not have exited this while loop. So let's try this. So again, I'll just give one test case and check 9, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. It gives me 6. So far it seems right. So I'm going to take this program. So I'm cutting and pasting it into the online portal. So this is my online portal. I start with a blank template and I'm going to put it here. Right, so I'm cutting and pasting it and I'll save and compile and run. So when I compile and run, let me see the results. I seem to have passed all the test cases, and if I have passed all the private test cases or the public test cases, as you see here, whatever you see in given to you. So we have two kinds of test cases. One is called public test case and another is called private test case. The public test cases are shown to you, the private test cases are not shown to you. When I submit, it actually evaluates against the private test cases which are not shown to you. And let me see whether I got 100. So I seem to have 100 on 100. So in which case, this program seems to be correct. Okay. So one subtle thing that I want to show here is this other notion of what if I put an extra backslash n or things like that here. Right? So let's say I put a backslash n which is extra new line. This is something that we seem to do many times, right? So let's say I put a backslash n and I compile and run. We would get what is called the presentation error. So this is something that many of you posted on the forum, that your output is correct, but there is something called presentation error. So actually it clearly says what a presentation error is. So the expected output is 7 and instead we have printed 7 backslash n, right? So what it really says is just get rid of the backslash n. And it seems like many of you are doing this. You want to get rid of the backslash n. So instead of removing it from the printf, you seem to be doing this. Put a backslash b, which stands for backspace. So let's say I did that. I do a compile and run on that. You get this really bizarre error. It says could not compile at this time, try later. So this backslash b is not something that's supported by the compiler to be displayed properly, and the compilation actually fails here. So it may sound bizarre to you. Instead of giving it to you as an error, the compilation itself seems to be failing, but it's not the compiler which fails. It's just that it's a bizarre way of giving this error out. So instead, I'm not going to monkey around with this. What I'm going to do is I'm just going to comment this line and get rid of the backslash n. So if once I get rid of the backslash n, things are fine. So I compile and run it. I pass all the test cases. I submit, and this is okay. Right? So I would get 100 on 100. So one nice thing that this program has is if the number is, so this is a test case that I didn't talk to you about. So let's say I give you this number. I test it with 3, right? It's a single digit number, which means you should not do any more processing. So it should exit with 3 itself. And that's something that the program automatically takes care of. So look at this. If the very first time you get an n itself is less than or equal to 9, then you don't execute this while loop, you directly print the number. So clearly this program will work correctly only if you have numbers which are positive, right? For negative numbers, it will print the negative number as it is, and digital root is not defined for negative number. So for any number that is positive, it is finding out the correct digital sum. So this is just a small video that I wanted to show you on how to solve this problem and how to write code. And I'm hoping that this will help you in breaking your barrier and being able to translate ideas into code. We are hoping to also actually show such sessions for the subsequent weeks. So we'll take some of these slightly difficult problems and show you how to solve the problem and also how to write programs with it. So thank you very much, and I wish you all the best for this course. I am sure that you are enjoying this course. There are a few pain points that you see with respect to presentation and so on. So overall, I hope that you are enjoying the course. Thank you and bye.